Dear Nobel laureates, excellencies, distinguished guests, colleagues and students, ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege and pleasure as Pro Vice-Chancellor of Uppsala University to welcome you all to Uppsala and to this grand auditorium for a panel discussion with the Tunisian Dialogue Quartet. The Quartet has, as you all know, been awarded the 2015 Nobel Peace Prize, and they've done so, and I quote, as their work speaks to the very core of Alfred Nobel's will and his vision of fraternity, disarmament, and peace building. As the chair of the Norwegian Nobel Committee put it at the prize ceremony in Oslo the other day. The laureates' work have led to a platform for peace and non-violent resolution of conflicts, with strong institutions to ensure stability and justice, and to promote dialogue and cooperation. If we want peace, there is one weapon more powerful than any other, and that is dialogue. In order to achieve respect and mutual understanding, we need to meet and we need to talk. Dear Nobel laureates, you are examples to us all. You have shown us a road to peace in a troubled situation. Thank you for coming to Uppsala today. As you can notice, your presence here means a lot to Uppsala University and to all friends of the university. We are honored by your presence. You are most welcome. We look forward to this session, and I will now give the floor to Professor Peter Wallensten, who will further introduce the laureates and the other panelists here, and then moderate the discussion to follow. So once again, a warm welcome, thank you, and please, Professor Wallensten, the floor is yours. Please, thank you.
Salam alaikum. Al-Hudur al-Kiram. Marhaba bil jamia. Peace be with you, dear participants. Welcome to you all to Uppsala University. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I'm honored to be conducting this discussion that we are going to have with the four representatives of the Tunisian Quartet, the winners of the 2015 Nobel Peace Prize. So let me quickly introduce the four that you will hear more from as we go along. Next to me is Madame Ouidad Bouchamoui, President of the Tunisian Confederacy of Industry, Trade and Handicraft. Next is Mr. Mohamed Fadel Mahmoud, President of the National Bar Association. Followed by Mr. Abdesattar Ben Moussa, President of the Tunisian Human Rights League, and Mr. Hussein Abbasi, General Secretary of the Tunisian General Labor Union. Let me join me in applauding them for their achievements. Just so that you know, we have an interpreter at the very end. Thank you for your work. So we are going to have a discussion on the topics that relate to Tunisia, the Arab Spring, and peace in the world. And to do this, we are helped by two persons based in Sweden, but very knowledgeable about the region and about Tunisia. So to my left is Ms. Fanny Hergestam, a journalist and author, based in Tunisia since 2012, reporting for Swedish radio and television to the country's most important public service companies. She moved to Tunisia to write the book, This Is Our Time, Det Här Är Vår Tid. You have the book?
Actually, I don't have it here, but I'll be happy to show it later.
Which follows four women and their daily life during almost 3 years. Three of the women were members of the Constituent Assembly that wrote the new constitution. This book was nominated for the Swedish Grand Journalism Prize. And she also this year received the prize for La Francophonie here in Uppsala. So we're very happy that you can join us and be with us here.
Thank you very much.
And at my very extreme here is University Lecturer Adel El-Sayed Sbar from Uppsala. He's a senior research fellow at the West Asia North Africa Institute, a non-profit think tank based in Amman, Jordan, and is chaired by His Royal Highness Prince El Hassan bin Talal. The Institute focuses on three concerns: human security, climate change, and social justice. And Adele works with regional resilience building policies broadly across all of these themes. Adele is a lecturer in Middle East Studies at Uppsala University and has a master's degree from the University of St. Andrews. I, in particular, also note that he has substantial courses in peace studies. So, welcome, Adele. Dear laureates and audience, we are all welcoming you to the city of Dag Hammarskjöld, the UN Secretary General that has managed to make the United Nations and the quest of peace and security the central concern for a whole generation. Indeed, one of his many colleagues was a distinguished Tunisian diplomat and the first person from Africa to be president of the UN General Assembly, His Excellency Mongi Slim, who actually visited Uppsala and placed a wreath on Hammarskjöld's grave here in 1962. The plane crash that ended Hammarskjöld's life a year before, more than 50 years ago, still is a mystery. And in November this year, the United Nations General Assembly passed a resolution asking member states to submit any information they may have on this particular issue. This university continuously honors Hammarskjöld and his legacy. And you, as your guide while you are here, are guided by the present holder of the Dag Hammarskjöld Chair of Peace and Conflict Research, which was created by the Swedish Parliament to commemorate Hammarskjöld's 20 years after his death, and that is Professor Håvard Hegre. At the end of this session, I will also ask the executive director of the Dag Hammarskjöld Foundation, a legacy institution of Hammarskjöld, Mr. Henrik Hammargren, to present the foundation's work with respect to our discussion. So let us recall why we are here today. This can most easily be done by using the formulation of the Norwegian Nobel Committee in handing out your prize on October 9, and 3 days ago you also received the honors associated with this. So let me quote the Norwegian Committee award its prize to the Tunisian National Dialogue Quartet for its decisive contribution to the building of a pluralistic democracy in Tunisia in the wake of the Jasmine Revolution of 2011. The Arab Spring originated in Tunisia, and the country has seen a democratic transition based on a vibrant civil society with demands respects for basic human rights. The committee goes on to say, the example shows that civil society institutions and organizations can play a crucial role in a country's democratization. And that such a process, even under difficult circumstances, can lead to free elections and peaceful transfer of power. The Norwegian Nobel Committee thus expresses its hope that this year's prize will contribute towards safeguarding democracy in Tunisia and be an inspiration to all those who seek to promote peace and democracy in the Middle East, North Africa, and the rest of the world. End of quote. And as you can hear, there are many elements here, not the least that this revolution was more peaceful and continues on a peaceful track. It may be a Tunisian in origin, but still provides lessons for other countries that would like to recreate the human dignity that was lost during years of dictatorship. Indeed, what I understand is that this is also what the Tunisians prefer to call the change, the dignity revolution. So let me then ask you a question to each one of you, and starting with Mrs. Buchamowi. Although your work is as a quartet, I'm curious to know what each of your organizations have contributed to this work that makes the quartet so successful. So Mrs. Buchamowi, what do you say to this question?
Thank you. Thank you to be here today. even it's a Sunday. We are very proud to be here to share with you our experience, the Tunisian exception, the Tunisian experience. The end of 2010 and 2000 and beginning to 2011, people in Tunisia shouted in one voice, we want dignity, we want democracy, freedom, and we want jobs. For those three reasons, we as Confederation of Industry, Trade and Commerce and Handicraft, we said we have a role to play. We have a role to play to respond to those people, to Tunisian people, of course, and to answer and to give them a hope. For those reasons, we were, and we, with my colleagues, four of us, we decided to be a quartet and to deal this national dialogue, just to respond to Tunisian people for having jobs, for having dignity, and for having freedom. I think now freedom, Tunisia, we have freedom in Tunisia. We have, because we are open country, but we are now, we have to succeed on our transition economy as we, to keep our democratic transition. So for our role as employers, as investors, something which is for those reasons we decide to be in this quartet.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, and Mr. Mohamed Fadel Mohamed Mahmoud.
بدوري أود أن أشكركم على هذه الاستضافة وعلى حفاوة الاستقبال وهذا ليس بغريب عن الشعب السويدي. وليس بغريب عن عراقته ومثلما أنتج ألفريد نوبل وهامرشولد هو اليوم أيضا الشعب السويدي هو رائد في عديد المجالات وخاصة في الاعتراف بحقوق الفلسطينيين.
To begin with, if I may extend my warmest thanks to all of you for the kind hospitality and warm welcome. This is not extremely strange for us to be so nicely welcomed here because this is a tradition of Sweden, and thanks to the extensive relationship between Sweden and our country. This country, Sweden, has given birth to Mr. Alfred Nobel, so needless to say who Alfred Nobel is, and you have always been pioneers, especially when you declared the recognition of the state of Palestine, which was a very important step for us.
وفي إجابة عن السؤال الذي وجه لي أود أن أشير وأن بالنسبة لمنظمتنا وهي الهيئة الوطنية للمحامين هي عريقة في مشاركتها في الشأن العام وفي الشأن السياسي بالمعنى النبيل للكلمة وهذه المشاركة ليست وليدة اللحظة الثورية الحالية بل هي قديمة منذ أن ناضل المحامون ضد الاستعمار ثم ناضلوا ضد الاستبداد وكانوا في مقدمة المشهد السياسي خلال الثورة وخلال عملية الانتقال الديمقراطي.
Well, and to reply precisely to the question that has been raised just now, the Bar Association or the Order of Lawyers in Tunisia is a very old association. It has always fought on the political arena, on the noble side of the political arena. So it's not a nascent organization. We have fought against colonialism and we have fought against totalitarianism. And we were at the front run for the 2011 uprising in Tunisia.
وفي الحقيقة فإن انخراطنا في الحوار الوطني كان بصورة تلقائية وكان موقفا رسميا صدر عن الهيئة الوطنية للمحامين وعن الاتحاد العام التونسي للشغل والرابطة التونسية للدفاع عن حقوق الإنسان واتحاد الصناعة والتجارة والصناعات التقليدية وكان ذلك الموقف إثر يعني اغتيال مع الأسف الشديد اغتيال لأحد نائبي المجلس الوطني التأسيسي آنذاك وكان في يوم رمزي من المفروض أن نحتفل فيه بعيد الجمهورية فكان موقف هذه المنظمات كان موقفا واضحا في الدعوة إلى إنشاء حوار وطني من أجل الخروج من الأزمة أولا ومن أجل إيجاد أفق جديد بواسطته نمر ونعبر إلى المؤسسات الدائمة لأن المؤسسات المؤقتة قد طالت أكثر من اللازم.
And the quartet, the national quartet for the national dialogue in Tunisia was united spontaneously. And therefore, the four organizations, namely the Tunisian Bar Association and the Tunisian Human Rights League, the Tunisian General Labor Union, and the Tunisian Confederation of Industry, Trade, and Craft, they made a single call asking for a national dialogue in order to open perspectives, prospects, and go forward. And unfortunately, when we had to step in, it was when one of the members of the Constituent Assembly got assassinated, and that coincided with the day of the Republic, the National Day of the Republic, and therefore our initiative was absolutely pivotal.
أنا آسف أن أطلت عليكم شيئاً ما ولكن المحامين يتكلمون كثيراً وهذه طبيعتهم ولكن أريد أن أختم بتوجيه الشكر لكم مجدداً على هذه الاستضافة وأن أقول بأن جائزة نوبل للسلام هي فيها رسالة واضحة للشعب التونسي بالطبع ولكن أيضاً لكافة شعوب العالم المحبة للسلام وفيها رسالة واضحة للقول بأن كافة الخلافات يمكن أن تحل بواسطة التفاوض وبواسطة الوفاق وبواسطة التنازلات حتى وإن كانت مؤلمة في بعض الأحيان وشكرا.
And apologies for having spoken a little bit too long. As you know, lawyers are a little bit by nature talkative. But again, I would like to extend my thanks again to you and to tell you that the Nobel Peace Prize that has been awarded to us is a message not only for Tunisia, but to all peace-loving nations throughout the world. And tell you as well that another message key for us is that conflict, no matter how serious they are, they can definitely be solved through dialogue, concessions, and even if the concessions are a little bit difficult to take, but they can be necessary.
Thank you. Mr. Abdul Ben Musa, please. Abdul Sattar Ben Musa.
شكرا لكم وأنا مسرور جدا بأن أكون في مدينة العلوم وكم نحن في حاجة في بلادنا إلى تنمية العلوم. أنا أحمل قبعتين، أنا كنت عميد المحامين في تونس 2004-2007 في عهد الاستبداد في عهد نظام بن علي، أين كانت المحاماة دائما مناضلة، كنا نقول بن علي من ورق بن علي يحترق واحترق فعلا، وكنا نناضل مع بقية المنظمات. الرابطة التونسية للدفاع عن حقوق الإنسان التي أرأسها منذ سنة 2011 هي أول منظمة حقوق الإنسان في إفريقيا وفي العالم العربي. كانت تناضل مع بقية المنظمات من أجل ضمان حقوق الإنسان في بعدها الكوني والشمولي، تعرضت إلى الهرسلة، تعرضنا إلى كثير من الضغطات معها في عهد بن علي.
Once again, I would like to say how happy I am to be here, to be in the city of knowledge, and we desperately need knowledge worldwide and in our country specifically. I have been from 2002 to 2007. I was in the Bar Association as well, and we fought then relentlessly against the authoritarian regime, against Ben Ali regime at that period. And from 2011 onward, I have been leading the Tunisian Human Rights League, and we have also fought for not only human rights for our country, but for the universal aspect of the universality of human rights worldwide.
كنا نناضل المنظمات الأربعة من أجل حقوق الإنسان في بعدها الكوني الشمولي. كنا نحلم بالديمقراطية. كنا أيضا نناضل من أجل الحرية. فلما الشعب استفاق يعني وأراد الحياة كان يردد الشعب يريد الديمقراطية يريد الحرية ساندناه في ذلك ويعني الحركة الثوري كنا تقريبا في كامل مراحله نسانده وندعمه ووصلنا في إطار الحوار في إطار الحوار مع الأحزاب يعني كان حوارا صعبا ولكن بفضل يعني الثقة التي تتمتع بهذه المنظمات في الشعب التونسي وفي الطبقة السياسية عموما توصلنا إلى دستور يضمن حقوق الإنسان في بعده الكوني والشمولي الحقوق المدنية والسياسية الحقوق الاقتصادية والاجتماعية الحقوق البيئية والثقافية توصلنا أيضا إلى المساواة لأنه كان بعضهم يريدون أن يجعلوا أن تراجع عن حقوق المرأة فإذا بفضل ضغطنا وبفضل ضغطنا في الشارع أيضا وفي الحوار توصلنا إلى أن تكون المرأة مساوية للرجل حقوق المرأة وقع ما كسبها إقرارها والتأكيد على تطويرها حقوق أيضا التعبير وحرية الضمير حرية هامة جدا لم تكن لنا موجودة كل الحريات تقريبا أسسنا لها وساهمنا في إنجاح الانتخابات وفي قيام المؤسسات ولا إلى الآن لنا دور آخر نقوم به لتعزيز هذه المؤسسات ولإقرار السلم في تونس ليكون قدوة لبقية البلدان العربية وشكرا.
And again, we, the four organizations that we have just mentioned, we have always believed in democracy and freedom. And therefore, when the uprising, when people took to the streets to call for these very principles, we recognized ourselves and our claims in the voice of the people, and therefore we provided them with all the support possible, and then we started negotiating and interacting with the political parties in our country. And that dialogue was not easy at all, but because of the trust we had, because of the credibility that our societies had with the people, we managed to contribute in drafting the constitution that included and enshrined human rights, civil rights, political, social, and cultural rights, and also equality. Because some voices at that time wanted the constitution that would deny the equality and women's rights in our constitutions, but we wanted desperately to make sure that provisions in the constitution say that women are equal to man. We focused on the freedom of expression and freedom of conscience as well, because we deemed them important. And then we took part in setting up the institutions, which were interim institutions at that time, but that took too much time, and then therefore we stepped in again to make sure that we have long-standing institutions, because that's exactly what the country needs to develop.
Thank you. And the last word, Mr. Hussein Abbasi, please.
بداية صباح الخير للجميع.
يلا فيس. Well, to begin with, a very good morning to all of you.
أريد أن أحيي المشرفين على تنظيم هذا اللقاء وأيضا أريد أن أحيي هذا الحضور الكريم من الطالبات والطلبة وقد أتوا بهذا العدد الغفير ونحن نعلم أن اليوم هو يوم أحد فذاك هو اهتمام بالتجربة التونسية وهم شغوفون لمعرفة ما توصلنا إليه في إطار الرباعي الرحاعي للحوار لإنقاذ تونس.
First of all, I would like to thank all those who have participated in making this possible, in organizing this session of discussion. I would like to thank you all, students, that despite that today is a Sunday, you're here with us, and this is a genuine interest from you about the Tunisian events, the Tunisian freedom, and you are very keen to know about it, and also hopefully keen to find out what the Quartet has done in Tunisia.
أنا جد سعيد بحضوري معكم وأنا جد فخور خاصة وأن كانت لي فرصة في هذا الصباح أن أجلس على كرسي العمداء المتعاقبين على هذه الجامعة ولي
كي أمضي في السجل الذهبي لهذه المؤسسة. And I am very happy as well, and somehow proud, specifically that this very morning, early when we arrived, I had the honor to sit on the seat of all the deans of this famous institution, and I had to sign the guest book, which somehow made me feel very proud.
ولكن سعادتي كانت أكثر حين تعرفت على أن في هذه الجامعة دائرة تعنى بتدريس السلم وفض النزاعات في العالم وهذه مفخرة لهذه الجامعة التي تعنى بالسلم في العالم.
And I'm even happier when I found out at a later stage this morning that there is in this university a Department of Peace and Conflict Research. And somehow it makes me extremely happy and proud because such a full-fledged department in charge of such an important topic is something very close to my heart.
أنا أمين عام لمنظمة اسمها الاتحاد العام التونسي للشغل. هذه المنظمة تأسست في 20 جان في من القرن الماضي 1946 ونحن سنحتفل في 20 جان في القادم بذكرى السبعين لهذه المنظمة العريقة.
Well, I am the Secretary General of the Tunisian General Labour Union that was created on the 20th of January 1946, and therefore next year we are going to be celebrating the 70th anniversary of our union.
ما تعرفونه أنتم الطلبة وحتى الباحثين وأن النقابات في العالم تعنى بالدفاع عن الحقوق الاجتماعية الدفاع عن حقوق الأجراء الاجتماعية والاقتصادية.
Well, as you know, as students and researchers, that labor organizations have got as a major interest the defense for the workers' rights, social rights, and economic rights of workers.
ولكن هذه المنظمة التي لي شرف رئاستها الآن هي منذ التأسيس كانت بالإضافة إلى هذا الدور الاجتماعي أيضا تلعب الدور الوطني والسياسي كلما كانت البلاد في حاجة إلى مثل هذه الأدوار.
And as Secretary General of this labor union that I'm heading, since the inception of this labor union, in addition to this very mandate of our organization, we have always had a very important interest to the political dimension in our country. So whenever the country, the nation needed a support, we stepped in to help out.
والأمين العام الأول المؤسس لهذه المنظمة قد اغتاله الاستعمار الفرنسي في 5 ديسمبر من سنة 1952 أي بعد 6 سنوات فقط من تأسيس هذه المنظمة.
And the first secretary general who actually headed this labor organization was assassinated by the colonial forces on the 5th of December 1952, and that was just about 6 years after the creation of our union.
لعلمكم وقع اغتياله ليس لأنه كان مدافعا في تلك الفترة عن حقوق الأجراء ولكن كان يدافع على تحرير البلاد وكان متحمل ومتقمص للدور السياسي في تلك الفترة ولهذا السبب وقع اغتيال.
And contrary to what you may think, he has not been assassinated or targeted because he was defending the labor's and the workers' rights. He got assassinated because he was keen to liberate the country. He was committed politically, and that is the reason for his assassination.
ولذا ميزتنا هو الدفاع عن حقوق الأجراء ولكن أيضا الاعتناء بالشأن السياسي والشأن العام للبلاد.
And this is how this tradition continued, that in addition to help, to claiming and defending the rights of the workers, we always had a say on the political situation in our country.
وهذا ما قمنا به خلال هذا التاريخ الطويل.
And this is what we have been doing through this long history.
ولكنه كلفنا أزمات كثيرة متتالية وسقط العديد من الشهداء من النقابيين من أجل الدفاع على شأن الوطن.
But that has obviously costed us a lot, and many of the members of our unions got assassinated and paid the price for this commitment. And this was so even after the liberation of Tunisia.
وباعتبار أن المنظمة الجماهيرية الأقوى في البلاد والأكثر تمثيلية والأكثر إشعاعاً والأكثر انتشاراً كان من الواجب علينا أن لا نترك بلادنا تعصف بها الرياح بعد نجاح ثورة شبابنا في طرد الدكتاتور بن علي.
And therefore, I gave you this little background to tell you that our organization, which has such a huge representativity, could absolutely not stand by looking at what was happening to our country. And when the youth took to the streets and managed to oust the dictator, and therefore we felt the need to participate.
وكنا أيضا نشاهد مآل كل الثورات التي شهدتها المنطقة العربية فتحولت من ثورات معلقة عليها أمال إلى نقمة وإلى تقاتل وإلى تطاحن وإلى حروب أهلية وإلى مصارع للنزاع.
And obviously what was a source of energy for us as well is when we looked around us in the area and we saw the Arab Spring sweeping throughout the Arab countries, some of the revolutions unfortunately became a curse on their nations. And there has been violence and infighting, and therefore we thought our role is absolutely fundamental.
فكان من واجبنا أن نلتقي مع الرباعي ومع كل قوى المجتمع المدني العاملة والمحبذة للسلام بأن نقوم بعمل ما لمصلحة بلادنا.
And therefore we thought to ourselves, well, we absolutely need to get together to work hand in hand with the Quartet and with all civil society organizations who were lending hands to us in order to save our country.
ولو لم نقم بهذا العمل ولم نتحمل مسؤولياتنا فنكون قد ارتكبنا خيانة بالنسبة لشعبنا.
And if we hadn't done so, it would have been taken as a non-respect, as a violation to our promises to our country.
الحوار نجح بفضل تلاقينا وبفضل العمل المشترك الذي قمنا به مع بعضنا البعض.
And the quartet and the dialogue only succeeded because we found commonalities among us.
ولكن الأمر لم يكن بالسهل وباعتبار أن منظمة جماهيرية قد ساندنا ودعمنا عمل الرباعي بالإضرابات وبالمسيرات وبالتجمعات الكبرى حتى نرضخ الأحزاب لكي تأتي الحوار الوطني.
And it hasn't absolutely not been, you know, a walk in the park. Our work wasn't. We contributed by staging sit-ins, gatherings, strikes in order to put enough pressure on the political parties who wouldn't come to the dialogue to come to the negotiating table.
أريد أن أتحدث عن الحوار الوطني يجب ساعات وساعات ولكن أظن أني قد أطلت عليكم فعلا ولكن هذا هو بسطة موجزة عن هذا الحوار الذي استغرق في جلساته العلنية أكثر من 164 ساعة ولكن استغرق أكثر من 1700 ساعة هو العمل في الكواليس والعمل للثنائي والثلاثي مع الأحزاب حتى يقع إقناعهم وحتى تنجح الجلسات العلنية والنتيجة هو أننا نجحنا وإن شاء الله المناطق التي تشهد بؤر توتر تستند إلى هذا الاستثناء التونسي حتى يمكنها تجنيب شعوبها الدمار والخراب.
And I realize that I've been a little bit monopolizing the floor here, but I mean, if I was to talk to you about the national dialogue, it would take hours. What I gave you is a little abstract of what we did. But let me tell you something important as well, that during the dialogue, the number of hours that we spent in publicly speaking about the dialogue was about 164 hours. But behind closed doors and on a bilateral and trilateral levels, we spent 1,700 hours speaking and negotiating with the partners to make sure that the work we do behind the doors is translated into success when we go to the open and public speeches. And one last thing I would like to say is that hopefully what we did in our country is going to be a source of inspiration to the other countries who are trying desperately to sort their affairs.
Thank you very much. I think you have helped us to understand the different perspectives and that you also forming the quartet means searching for commonalities. And it's been very impressive and very important to hear your accounts here. So thank you very much. And let me now proceed to the panelists on the other side. Fanny Hegerstam, the floor is yours, please.
Thank you very much, Peter. First of all, thank you very much Uppsala University and Dag Hammarskjöld Foundation for having me here. It's a great honor. And I'd like to direct a congratulations to the quartet also. I'll get straight to one of the questions I have, which will be on the topic of mistrust. Because mistrust was a very important component of the crisis in 2013 when the National Dialogue in Tunisia was created and when the quartet was created. There was mistrust of different kinds. One kind was the political mistrust between parties. So between the governing coalition led by the Islamist party on the one hand and the secular opposition on the other hand. And this mistrust was very clear and very present in the whole society of Tunisia. And it was manifested in the media, in the debates. The tone was very harsh, and even deputies in the the temporary parliament, the Constituent Assembly, left the assembly. There was no dialogue. And then, at this time, the quartet was created. Today, on the other hand, this mistrust is not really visible in Tunisia. And I would like to ask the quartet, why? Like, what changed in the political landscape of Tunisia since then, as you see it? You may choose among you whoever feels compelled to answer first. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Yes, yeah. Please.
As you know, we are not politicians. We are from the civil society. But we are concerned about the state, what is happening, what was happened for in Tunisia. For those reasons, I mean, we decided to have this dialogue. And just to give a simple message to politicians, they must be together, they must discuss together, they must sit together. This only way for Tunisia is dialogue. And I think we gave them a lesson, I mean, for political leaders, how they can be and be together in politics. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Please, yes.
هو تتم لما قالته زميلتي سيدة بوشماوي صحيح نحن مجتمع مدني ولكننا نمارس دور وواجب اليقظة اليقظة تجاه الشأن العام تجاه ما يحدث في تونس تجاه عملية الانتقال التي كنا حريصين على نجاحها منذ الأيام الأولى للثورة ففي الأيام الأولى للثورة كانت هناك ثقة لدى الطبقة السياسية بين بعضهم البعض وكانت الأمور تسير نحو اتجاه نعتقد أنه كان صائبا والمتمثل في الانتخابات الأولى الانتخابات التأسيسية والتي أفرزت المجلس الوطني التأسيسي لسنة 2011
It is true that what my colleague, Mrs. Wizard, had just said, indeed, we are civil organizations, that is a fact, but we had the role of this awakening. We needed to have this awakening activities towards the people, towards the political parties, and then we tried to make them aware about the importance of succeeding in this transitional period. And from the first days of the revolution, there was some kind of trust, and therefore we managed to boost the process and to go to the constituent elections, leading to the setup of the constituent assembly in 2011.
لكن هذه الثقة اهتزت لاحقا بين السياسيين بين بعضهم البعض بين السياسيين والمجتمع المدني بسبب عدم الالتزام بالفترة التي كانت موكولة للمجلس الوطني التأسيسي لتحرير دستور البلاد الجديد والمرور إلى المؤسسات الدائمة عن طريق انتخابات تشريعية ورئاسية شفافة وتعددية ولتبرز إرادة الناخب حقيقة لكن هذا لم يحدث في فترة سنة وطالت المدة الانتقالية واستأسد المجلس الوطني التأسيسي وخاصة من كان يحكم في ذلك في تلك الفترة ولم يكن هناك أفقا سياسيا رحبا بل بالعكس تعقدت الوضعية بالاغتيالات السياسية التي طالت أولا الشهيد المحامي الأستاذ شكري بالعيد ثم في فترة ثانية مثل ما أشرت إلى ذلك في بداية مداخلتي بالاغتيال الذي تم يوم 25 جوليو 2013
And, So the trust I have just mentioned, unfortunately, got a little bit endangered in a way, and the political parties among them no longer had that trust among them, and therefore there was a call as well, because we thought that the Constituent Assembly, the interim assembly, all those were taking way too much long. The time frame that was initially dedicated for them was trespassed, and the promises for the presidential and parliament elections were also a little bit. There was some kind of procrastination in holding those promised elections, and therefore there was no prospects. And especially what happened then was the assassinations. As you may always know, there was the assassination of Mr. Shukri Belaid. That was a very big blow to the situation. In addition to the second assassination that happened, that coincided with the National Day of the Republic on the 25th of July 2013.
Thank you. Please.
يعني في 2011 بعد الثورة مباشرة كان فما وفاق كان هناك تكون برلمان بدون انتخابات ممثل لهذه المنظمات وهذا البرلمان اقترح قوانين اقترح يعني تخص الحريات تخص الاعلام تخص تكوين الجمعيات تخص تكوين الاحزاب وهي قوانين تضاهي وفق المعايير الدوليه وهي ما زالت ساريه الى الان لكن بعد الانتخابات التشريعيه لما افرزت الانتخابات 23 اكتوبر 2011 افرزت عند ذلك حزب النهضه عنده الاغلبيه وكونت الترويكا حزبا كونت حكومه ورأينا كمجتمع مدني أن هناك رغبة في تغيير نمط المجتمع التونسي وهناك رغبة دساتير كانت المسودات الأولى كانت مخالفة لحقوق الإنسان لا تستجيب لطموحات الشعب لا تستجيب يعني مطالب الديمقراطية والحرية كانت تجعل من المرأة مكملة للرجل هذه كلها جعلت منا كمجتمع مدني نحن مجتمع مدني قوة ضغط وقوة اقتراح وخاصة بعد الاغتيالات السياسية التي حدثت واغتيال الجنود واغتيال رجال الأمن أين شعرنا بخوف شعرنا أن مطالب الشعب والثورة سيقع انتكاسة وربما سيحدث مثل ما حدث في البلدان الأخرى البلدان الشقيقة تحركنا ضغطنا وقمنا بالحوار وفي نهاية الأمر الدستور كان مخالفا للمسودات الأولى كما قلت في البداية الدستور كان يؤسس لدولة ديمقراطية مش لخلافة تؤسس دولة ديمقراطية تقوم على التداول السلمي على السلطة
سابقا كان رئيس الجمهورية لدينا لم يجلس على الكرسي لا يغادر الكرسي إلا عندما يموت والآن أصبح رئيس الجمهورية دورتين فقط مثل بقية الدول الديمقراطية. الدولة أيضا نجحنا في الفصل بين الديني والسياسة, يعني في بلدنا الآن دولة مدنية وهذا هام جدا, وهذه فصول لا يمكن تنقيحها, لا يمكن لأي سلطة سياسية في المستقبل أن تنقحها. بطبيعة الحال يعني ما يحدث الآن في تونس, الأحزاب السياسية كل حزب يريد أن يصل إلى السلطة والاختلاف يضح, لكن الحياة السياسية ليست كما كانت في سنة 2012 و13. الحياة السياسية الآن يمكن في اعتقادي بعد إرساء المؤسسات الدستورية, المحكمة الدستورية والمجلس الأعلى للقضاء وبقية المؤسسات, في اعتقادي سنخطو خطوة هامة نحو الديمقراطية.
What I would also like to add is that after the revolution in 2011, we had a parliament that was set up without the elections, and that parliament then enacted laws on the freedom of speech, freedom of information, freedom of creating associations, and that interim parliament managed to create a coherent and acceptable constitution at that time. But then after the elections on the 23rd of October 2011 and the Troika government that was set up at that time, there we felt there was attempts to redraft the constitution, and that was somehow different from what the claims of the people wanted. I give you a couple of examples. Human rights were no longer so enshrined in the new constitution, and the ambitions of the people were not enshrined there either. And even there was a provision whereby women were considered as a complement, as complementary to man, and therefore that was absolutely not what we were fighting for. And therefore we as civil society organizations, we acted as a pressure group, and then because we thought it was absolutely vital to act after the assassinations again of soldiers, of opponents, and then we felt that our rights were somehow being denied, and we didn't want to even think that our country would follow suit to what happened in the other Arab countries. That is something that we did not want at all, and. We have now managed to have a different constitutions that which guarantees the rotation on power. So we have standing provisions in our constitution that no government can change regarding this specific standing provision, whereby powers have to be revolving. And as you know, before. Presidents in Tunisia, I mean, he was there until he dies, but the new constitution no longer accepts that. It's two terms of office, and that is the end of the story. And then we managed to have also provisions separating religion from the state. That is also a standing provision in our new constitution. And again, reiterate that these very mandates, these very provisions will absolutely not be changed at all.
Thank you. And Mr. Abbasi, please.
شكرا. أن أتكلم في الأخير ماذا عساني أن أضيف؟ فقط أريد أن أذكر بأن الحوار الوطني يظهر أن الجميع مركز وكأنه انطلق في 2013. للتذكير أن الحوار الوطني انطلق مع الرباعي هذا في 15 أكتوبر 2012. وفي أول جلسة المؤتمر الوطني للحوار كان شكري بالعيد, الشهيد شكري بالعيد كان معناها ممثلا وحاضرا في هذا المؤتمر الأول.
Well, speaking last, but I try to add a little bit more elements about the national dialogue, which we all think that it only started, it started in 2011. But let me just tell you that there has been a series of meetings before that, on the 15th of October, where Shukri Belaid, who later on got assassinated, he was participating in the early sessions of the national dialogue.
ولكنه أخذ نسقا تصاعديا بعد اغتيال الأول ثم الاغتيال الثاني.
But this national dialogue got a different tone after the first and the second assassinations.
والسؤال هو كيف توصلنا إلى إقناع الأحزاب المتناقضة مع بعضها البعض في الجلوس نحو الجلوس على مائدة حوار واحدة.
And the question that, to which I think we have to ask is how did we as Quartet manage to talk the parties into staying around the table to manage the crisis.
سأكون محددا للإجابة على هذا السؤال.
I will be precise in answering this question.
بدون أن أدخل في التفاصيل أو في النتائج التي توصلنا إليها.
And I'm not going to talk about the details or the outcomes.
قد تكون أسئلتكم أنتم إلينا لاحقا.
Maybe this will come up during the Q&A later.
ولكن ما أريد التركيز عليه وأننا كيف توافقنا نحن منظمة نقابية مع رئيسة أو مع منظمة أصحاب العمل المتعارف عليه هو أن معناها هذان المنظمتان تقريبا كالخط متاع السك الحديد معناها يبقى متوازنان ولا يلتقيان ونلتقي فلا فسيف سيكون المصير تقريبا.
Well, I think one of the things I have to highlight here is how did the employers' organizations, represented by Mrs. Widad here, and my organization, the labor organization, how did we manage to talk to each other? Because we are somehow mutually exclusive. This is what we know about employers and employees. Where just like the two tracks of the railway, we never meet. And then if we meet, well, you know what happens when tracks meet.
ولكن التقينا لأن مصلحة الوطن تطلب ذلك.
Well, we did meet because the supreme interest of the nation required that.
فمشاكلنا ومسائلنا الاجتماعية تفض في مجالاتها العادية.
So, all the problems we had to sort out, like political or social or economic, we said we would deal with them on a different, in a different arena.
ونحن الآن لا أقول نتصارع ولا نقول هناك دائما نقاشات حادة بيننا وهي ما زالت إلى حد الآن.
But still, I mean, that doesn't mean that we are buddies. I mean, we still have opposed ideas, conflictual ideas, but that's life between the two organizations.
ولا تستغربون بأن نقول لكم نحن الآن لدينا خلافات في مفاوضات الاجتماعية بين بعضنا البعض.
So I mean, you wouldn't be surprised if I tell you that we do have contentious points when we talk about the during the social dialogue.
ولكن قدرتنا أن نترك هذا له مجالاته. ولكن عندما تكون البلاد مهددة والمخاطر تحدق بها فالمسألة تصبح أمر ثاني.
So, but we agreed to set aside this conflict, this contentious point, because the moment the future, the destiny of a nation is at stake, we thought this is far more important to deal with.
وربما هذه كانت نقطة القوة التي أقنعنا بها الأحزاب من اللي يبدو فيما بينهم غير متفاهمين وغير
متفقين
معناها متوافقين ومبتعدين وحتى بعض الأحزاب أصبحت بينها وبين معناها فيما بينها عداوات إلى حد أن رؤساء الأحزاب حتى مجرد المصافحة مع بعضهم ما يتصافحوش معناها.
And I say that because we think this is a very strong point, and this is precisely what we use in order to convince the parties, to tell them if we manage, then you should be able to manage to go to a consensual approach. And because I can tell you that some of the parties were so in opposition that there was somehow of feud among them, and some of the leaders wouldn't even shake hands when they meet.
كنا نقول لهم خذوا التجربة أو خذوا هذا الدرس من بين زوز منظمات كيفاش التقاوا مع بعضهم. من المفروض عليكم أيضا أن تلتقوا من أجل مصلحة بلادكم.
And we simply said to them, you know, very plain, like take the example of these two otherwise different organizations, the labor, the employers and the employees, they managed to meet, so you should try to do the same.
كنا نقول لهم أنتم تريدون أن تصلوا إلى الحكم ولكن باش تحكموا ماذا ستحكموا؟ ستحكمون بلد. إذا البلد هذا ما نسمش نقضوه عبر الحوار فسيكون مصيره مصير كل الدول العربية الأخرى. خذوا التجربة اللي موجودة في الصومال وخذوا التجارب اللي موجودة في سوريا وفي غيره. معناها الحكم اللي مش وصلوله مش تلقاو بلد مدمر. معناها الشعب معناها مشرد. الفقر يأخذ حظه منه. وبالتالي ماكمش مش تلقاو بلد باش تحكموه مش تحكموا الخراب.
So we simply told them, now, what is your aim, I mean, as political parties? Well, you want to come to power, and therefore you want to rule a country. Now, if you want to rule a country, well, try to work to have a proper country to rule. Because if you don't do so, look around you, Somalia, Syria, well, you will come to power, but then would you run a country that is ruined, a country with thousands of displaced people, abject poverty? Is that the country you want to rule? If not, then you have to do what we did.
وأعتقد أن نجحنا في ذلك لأنه في نهاية المطاف تقريبا وفي أنا أسميها لحظات في الزمن فارقة معناها في الحياة الإنسانية هو أن هذه الأحزاب اقتنعت بأن لا مفر إلا من الذهاب إلى الحوار وفعلا هنا لابد من أن أحيي هؤلاء الأحزاب لأن لولا تفهمهم ولولا اقتناعهم بعملنا ما كان الحوار أن ينجح وما كنا وما كانت لهذه التجربة التونسية أن تنجح وما كنا نحن أيضا أن نتوج فأيضا رغم من الصعوبات والعراقيل التي سببوها إلينا ولكن في نهاية المطاف قناعتهم واستجابتهم تدعونا أن نحييهم بدورنا.
And but at the end of the day, we did succeed, and I believe that there has been decisive moment in our history, and therefore we managed to convince the parties into coming to the negotiating table. And I have to say that we need to salute them, to really greet the parties, because although they did cause a lot of problems, but we have to be fair enough and greet them and thank them for having shown the flexibility in time to contribute to the success of the dialogue, the success of Tunisia, and without them, we wouldn't have been crowned with the Nobel Peace Prize, and we wouldn't be here. So we thank them.
ومكنونا بهذا التعاون على أن التجربة التونسية نجحت، ولكن هي إجابة إلى كل المشككين في أن العرب مش ممكن باش تقام فيهم ديمقراطية. فهذا هو المثال والأمثلة ستأتي لاحقاً. إن شاء الله أن التجربة الديمقراطية في الدول العربية ممكنة.
And one thing I want to say as well is that the success of Tunisia is somehow an answer to all those who may believe that democracy and dialogue in the Arab world is simply not possible. Well, it did succeed in our situation, and all those who believe that democracy that it should be reached through dialogue, well, it happened in our country, so it should happen elsewhere as well.
Thank you. Thank you for illustrating this. So let's go to Mr. Adel, please.
Yeah, thank you. I'd like to remain on that point about the region and the Arab world. I think that, Ms. Bouchat-Maoui, you said that, you know, you mentioned the Tunisian exception, that Tunisia is the exception in the world, in this Arab world, but, and to some extent, that is obviously true, but there is, the challenges that Tunisia faces aren't unique in any way, is there? And I mean, you have mentioned the assassinations, you have mentioned terrorist threats from violent extremists. You have other challenges that are transnational by their very nature, such as climate change. Tunisia is now a transit country for migrants, isn't it? How do you think that your sort of experience about furthering a dialogue, because I really think that's a brilliant example of how to wage peace instead of waging war, isn't it? How do you think that could be exported and formulated in a regional setting? Do you have any partner organizations in other parts of this region that you work with? Could that be a way forward, do you think? Please.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I say that Tunisia is an exception because we have a long history. We have more than 3,000 years, and we are a peaceful country. We are tolerant people, and we are against wars, we are against arms, and we are against terrorism. So Tunisia, we are used to accept each other. We are used to listen to each other, and we are used to live with others. For those reasons, let us, an exception people in the region, and we have not to also ignore the role of civil society, other organization from civil society, the role of women, Tunisian women, and the role, of course, of young people. And because those young people are well educated, they have an open mind, and we have a good relation with all our neighbors. This is an exception. How we can, of course, we have challenges, because as I said, yes, we got our freedom, we got our experience, but we have other challenges. I mean, economic challenges, so we have to take care about our climate, we have to about our environment, we have to offer to investors, a good and best business environment. I think with this democracy, we'll have better governance, we'll be more transparent, and the civil society will control either the government and, the parliament. So we'll be there, we'll be present to say no to corruption, no to violence. And for this, I think the next step for us is to sit together and to find the best solution for our economy. And this, what Mr. Abbasi said, we have a big role to do, to be together, to communicate together more, to better, to convince each other to make those reforms to have a best and a competitive environment, business environment for our experience in Tunisia. For the second part of your question, we are not here just to give lessons to others or to say to them, you have to follow our experience. What we did, this experience succeeded in Tunisia. Maybe we can adapt this experience to others, but we have to take care about they. We have to take care about their environment. What is an exception also because it's done by Tunisian, by our services. So I think this is the exception for Tunisia. What we can advise others, countries in our region, is just listen to each other and to dialogue. Maybe if they need to listen to us, we can present to give them some ideas, not a lesson. That's it. Thank you.
Would you like to follow up on that? Or?
No, I really think that your points are very good on this matter. This is exactly the answer that I wanted.
Thank you.
However, I would like to sort of move on to, because I think that your point about advice, ideas, and not perhaps an exact replica of the Tunisian example. I think that, you know, that this is really what we want to. We want to look at the country specifics. I mean, you have Egypt, for instance, that also had an autocrat ousted, Hosni Mubarak. And there are civil society organizations there as well, but they haven't been able to get closer to each other, right? So, I mean, what are the reasons for that? I don't expect you to you know, be right on that, or you know, any other country as that, but there is something interesting about that fact, isn't it? That you were able to do this, and other countries weren't. I would argue that Tunisia has had a very long-standing tradition of a prominent role for women in society.
Yeah.
Sure. I think you're, you know, hats off for that. Really, how can we change that social norm in this region? How can we get more women onto the stage? Because I really think that civil society organizations can have a very important role in that.
Yes, please.
We need a lawyer to defend our rights.
هو في ال في الأصل أن الاستثناء التونسي هو استثناء معقول ومنطقي قبل كل شيء لأن مقومات النجاح كانت متوفرة في تونس ومن أهم مقومات النجاح هو ما أشرنا إليه في بداية هذه المداخلات من قوة المجتمع المدني من تجذر هذه الطبقة المثقفة من وجود لمستوى تعليمي حقيقي ومتفوق منذ سنوات ومنذ عقود ومنذ حتى مئات السنين باعتبار أن تونس كانت منبع لحضارات متعاقبة ولجامعات شأن جامعة أوبسالا مثلا جامعة الزيتونة في تونس هي من أعرق الجامعات ف كل هذا كان متوفر وولد لدى التونسي تلك الثقافة وثقافة الأخذ بالذات والمضي إلى الأمام وبالطبع لا ننسى وهذا ما أشرنا إليه وما أشرت إليه السيدة وداد والعميد عبد الستار أن المرأة في تونس تلعب دورا كبيرا فالمرأة في تونس تحررت منذ سنة 56 منذ سنة 1956 بفضل مجلة الأحوال الشخصية ولكن أيضا كان ذلك نتيجة نضالات بالطبع ونضالات شباب مثقف وشابات مثقفات وبالطبع جاءت طبقة سياسية نيرة إثر الاستقلال يتزعمها الزعيم الراحل بورقيبة الذي فرض بواسطة التشريع بالطبع هذه القوانين هذه الخصوصيات التونسية قد تكون متوفرة في بلدان أخرى وقد لا تكون متوفرة ودعوتنا بالنسبة لبقية الدول العربية هو أن تتم تقوية المجتمع المدني في هذه المدن وفي هذه الربوع العربية وكنت يعني شخصيا توجهت بهذا النداء إلى منظمة الأمم المتحدة بمناسبة استقبال الاتحاد الدولي للمحامين في نيويورك وتوجهت بأن تتوجه المنظمات الدولية حقيقة إلى المجتمع المدني إلى المرأة إلى المناضلين إلى الحقوقيين إلى المحامين وهذا ما يتنساه البعض المحاماة يمكن أن تلعب دورا رئيسيا وهذا ما أقوم به الآن مثلا بواسطتي كمحامي وكعميد الهيئة الوطنية للمحامين بتونس فأنا أتصل بزميلي عميد الهيئة الوطنية بليبيا من أجل إيجاد ربما أفكار قد تفرز حوارا أو تفرز حلولا لما يحصل في ليبيا
talk about the exception or the Tunisian exception, sorry. Indeed, I mean, there is somehow of an exception in Tunisia. And I would say that we managed to do what we did because we did have the fundamentals for that enabled us to go through this transition. One of most important fundamentals is the vibrant civil society organizations. That is one key element we also had an educated elite in our country as well, and also I think the educational system was excellent after independence. And as you know, Tunisia has been the cradle for several civilizations, and as we are here sitting in this auditorium in Uppsala University, we do have the University of Zaytuna, which is yet even an older university in the region. And therefore, the educational system we had was so good that it created an educated elite which had some kind of trust in its capacities. And as Mrs. Widad and Mr. Abdesattar have said rightly, women did have a pivotal role in Tunisia. And women in 1956, at that time, they got liberated because they had, at that time, we had a very forward-looking personal code or civil code at that time. And that created, and that was thanks to the post-independence government under the leadership, the wise leadership of President late Bourguiba at that time. We created a very good political elite at that time. And what I would like to say as well is that the specificities or the specifics of Tunisia, some of them may be available or in some other Arab countries, but not all of them. And therefore, I think what is lacking in the other Arab countries is the strength of the civil society organizations that unfortunately is not deeply seated enough. And when I was at the UN, I made a call, an appeal myself, and I said that the international organization should work with the lawyers' organizations, with CSOs, with women's organizations, because as you know, lawyers do play a very important role, and therefore we should be able to work with them. And one last example is I myself got in touch with my counterpart in Libya, in the Bar Association, to tell him, let's meet, let's exchange a few ideas, because this may be important for you.
May I?
Thank you.
Something for women, because Mr. Mahfoud talked about the status in 1956, even the new constitution. We, women and men, we have the same rights, equal rights and equal duties. And there is, I mean, we are before the law, in front of the law, we are equal. So we reinforce the role of women, even after 2011.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more question. And I'll let a woman ask the last question.
I'm not sure. Can you still hear me? I had the impression that my microphone was not working. Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So, I mean, unfortunately, I will switch subject to something a bit darker. I would love to stay on women's rights, but I think this question is somehow needed as well. It's about the recruitment to the terror organization, Islamic State. Several reports show that Tunisia is somehow the biggest exporter of fighters to the Islamic State. It's nothing entirely new. There have been numbers coming in reports since 2012. And there is no really strategy in Tunisia today to fight terrorism in the country. The country has also seen, as you may know, several attacks this year, three very severe ones, also smaller ones against security forces. So I would like to ask the quartet, why do you, like, according to you, to your perspectives, why do you think, just from Tunisia, there are that many young people traveling to Syria and Iraq and Libya? And also, on the same topic, what kind of preventions should society, the state, the authorities take to stop people from going? And what should be done when they come back? Because there's not really any plan for that today. I know this is a very large question. Maybe a couple of you or one of you would like to try to answer. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So can we just give your one or two points that you think are important for us to know? Yes, please, yes.
هو في الأصل الظاهرة الإرهابية ليست تونسية. هذه الظاهرة هي ظاهرة غريبة على تونس. ولما حدث أول اغتيال في تونس يعني كنا مشدوهين. هذا من جهة. من جهة ثانية الظاهرة الإرهابية هي تضرب الآن في كل مكان في العالم. ورأيتم جميعا الضربات الإرهابية التي لم تستشر أحد في تونس، في بيروت، في نيويورك، في باريس. هذه كلها ضربات إرهابية وليس لتونس علاقة بذلك. ثالثا ما تفيده بعض التقارير قد يكون صحيحا وقد يكون مبالغا فيه. فالأرقام الموجودة الآن يعني مختلف في شأنها في خصوص التونسيون الذين يذهبون أو يهاجرون بدعوى الجهاد. فأولا هؤلاء لا يهاجرون بدعوى الجهاد بل وربما يتم استقطابهم بصورة سهلة نظرا لوضعية الفقر والخصاصة والجوع والحرمان والتهميش. هذا من جهة. ومن جهة ثانية فأن هؤلاء سهل استقطابهم بواسطة المال ويقع توظيف الجانب الديني في قراءة متشددة لبعض الأفكار الدينية ويقع توظيف هؤلاء من أجل ما يسمى بالجهاد. فتونس ليست مصدرة للإرهاب على عكس ما يشاع، بل بالعكس. ما هو مطلوب الآن وهذا في إجابة عن الجزء الثاني من السؤال هو بالفعل هو أن نحمي شبابنا. كيف سنحمي شبابنا؟ بتحقيق أحلامه، بأن نحقق الانتقال الاقتصادي الآن والانتقال الاجتماعي. هذا الآن مطلوب وهذا سيكون بالطبع بالعمل كتونسيين ونحن سنعمل من أجل ذلك، ولكن أيضا نحن بحاجة إلى مساعدة أصدقائنا وأشقائنا وكافة المجموعة الدولية من أجل إنجاح التجربة الاقتصادية بالطبع لإبعاد شبح الإرهاب ولإبعاد شبح الهجرة الذي يقر مضجع أوروبا. حتى أوروبا يعني هي لها تساؤلات في خصوص هذه الهجرة.
The phenomenon of terrorism is homebred, is not Tunisian bred. It's something foreign to our fabric in our country. And we, as Tunisians, we were completely shocked after the first assassination in our country. And besides, terrorism is present in many, many countries of the world. So it's not Tunisia specific. We had it in Beirut, in New York, in Paris, and other attacks as well. And some of the reports and statistics that are being publicized about the number of foreign, what we call FTFs, the foreign terrorist fighters, are semi-reliable. We don't know for sure exactly what the number is. And one thing I want to tell about the recruitment of these Tunisians, the reason for that being abject poverty, famine in some parts, alienation in the society, and deprivation. These are key elements that have been misused or used by some people to recruit those fighters. In addition to that, there is the instrumentalization of religion or misinterpretation of some of the religious parts to give it a radical an extreme interpretation to somehow give a blessing to what they call the jihad. And Tunisia, what is required, sorry, which is the second part, what is required from us in order to prevent further this phenomenon is to protect our youth. We desperately need to protect our youth, and we can only protect them if we can help them materialize their hopes and aspirations in a smooth economic transition, social transition for the future. And therefore, we will do that internally from within. We are going to work on that track, but to make it materialize faster, I think we desperately need to the international community to back us up in that respect, especially that now that the flow of migration and also terrorism have become common challenges to all of us.
Thank you. I know there are many more answers on these questions, but I think a good seminar should not end with answers, it should end with questions. So I think we will have to stop right here. You are on a very tight program, and we have, I think, heard very fascinating explanations. So as the final word, I will now ask Mr. Henrik Hammargren to come up and say a little about the Hammarskjöld Foundation, and then I will explain how we end this setting.
I have just a request, please. May I ask all of you to come to Tunisia to visit us? You will find another country. Maybe you have to, you can't change your mind about Tunisia and about Islam. Please come to Tunisia.
Thank you. Thanks for the invitation.
Yeah.
Thank you for the invitation, and thank you, Professor.
You're welcome.
Honorable Nobel Peace Prize laureates, distinguished guests, it's indeed an honor for me to represent the Dag Hammarskjöld Foundation on an occasion like this, and being able to listen to your experience as you have shared them today to this audience. You are following in the footsteps of giants. Dag Hammarskjöld was one of these. In 1961, Hammarskjöld was posthumously awarded the Nobel Prize. We were reminded about the liberation struggle for Tunisia in one of the introductory remarks. At a recent visit by the president of the AU here, she reminded us also that Dag Hammarskjöld was sort of the secretary general of decolonization. And we were also honored by the state visit of the Tunisian president, who also wanted to present his commemoration to Hammarskjöld, that Hammarskjöld also offered his services in dialogue in solving the French-Tunisian conflict. However, that was turned down by the French. The president also had a very personal relationship to Hammarskjöld and met him just before his fatal trip to the Congo, where Tunisia had actually been very supportive in Hammarskjöld's efforts in settling the conflict and provided the peacekeeping troops in less than 24 hours. However, as we all know, Hammarskjöld perished in the fatal plane crash of 1961. And in the acceptance speech of the then Swedish ambassador to Oslo, or to Norway, in his very last sentence, the ambassador said that a foundation should be set up to commemorate the work of Dag Hammarskjöld. Now, since 1962, the foundation has in various ways commemorated Hammarskjöld's legacy, his mission and vision. And we have several programs in which we work to strengthen the UN and to build peace. One of these areas is very much linked to the work of the Quartet. For some years, we've been engaged in looking into what we call inclusivity in peace building. We all know that sustainable peace and building peace demands engagement at country level. It has to be owned at national level. It has to be owned at local level. And the Quartet, in a brilliant way, shows not only this ownership, but also fantastic leadership in building and sustaining peace. I can think of no better way, actually, than commemorating the complexity of Hammarskjöld's own vision and mission than by recognizing the work that your organizations have done. And I would like to use Dag Hammarskjöld's own words. The pursuit of peace and progress cannot end in a few years in either victory or defeat. The pursuit of peace and progress, with its trial and its errors, its successes and its setbacks, can never be relaxed and never abandoned. As I said, you walk in the footsteps of giants, and others will now follow you. I think it's a fantastic inspiration that the Quartet has set for others to follow. And I hope the audience can join me in thanking the Quartet for taking the time, and also to the professor for the moderation and the panelists. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.